episode, we leave the cage behind and put Reb back in his comfort zone, the war zone. This is right in Reb's wheelhouse, and you gotta feel good going in, especially since it's a canon film made by Golan Globus, three names well known for being the ultimate in awesome 80s rental store action. They helped make Chuck Norris a legend in such films as Invasion USA, which was sort of like Red Dawn if you replaced all the good guys with Chuck Norris.
It's time.
Yeah! Even better, you've got a star-studded ensemble cast, including the Superfly himself, Ron O'Neill, Robert Mitchum's son, James Mitchum, and Peter Fonda as the mercenary leader, Varelli, in a role that Richard Kiel wrote in his autobiography that he turned down. Yes, Peter Fonda was the second casting choice to EGA! Anyway, the setup for this movie is that a fictional country in Africa called Shinkasa is attempting to industrialize by constructing a hydroelectric dam in the region. This will have the unfortunate effect of displacing several villages on the river that will otherwise be flooded, and the natives there have formed an armed resistance against the government.
All Kuruba villages are rebel villages. In 6 months, all that you can see from here north, 100 miles, will be covered in 40 feet of water.
Well, hell, why'd you just put them out?
Can't! The press!
That's right. The press would have a field day covering a story about some heartless government constructing a dam, causing the river waters to rise and drive these helpless people from their homes. That's why the general here takes the much more diplomatic, politically correct approach and hires mercenaries to strafe them from helicopters with machine guns and rockets. Oh. Oh, God.
Holy shit!
Wait a minute, why couldn't we just flood them from their homes?
We can't! The press!
You know what would be a great way to maintain order? If we constructed some kind of robot cop. Yeah, the press would love that. And that'd be an awesome movie, RoboCop Goes to Africa. Actually, this plot is superficially very similar to Superfly TNT, which may explain why this guy turns to American mercenaries to settle this little rebellion in Africa. After all, we all know who the best killers really are.
I had the very best killers there are. White killers. White ones, baby.
So yeah, Peter Fonda plays the mercenary Captain Varelli, looking a hell of a lot like Connor McLeod, if Connor McLeod had a bitchin' grenade launcher. Hey wait, why did that guy jump toward the explosion? Superfly plays the team's ace pilot, filling his free time with a little mercenary crop dusting.
Cliff, are you crazy?
Maverick! He's the guy who brings Reb into the job. Reb plays our hero, the man without a backstory, TJ Christian.
TJ Christian, freedom fighter.
Well, look at it this way. You got something better going?
I had this one job. Worst 3 years of my life.
Be Captain America, Steve. Jam Captain America down their throats.
It wasn't the pay so much. Nobody knew what the hell was going on.
Especially that Bruno Matai dude.
This job is different, TJ. It's very clear cut here. We're fighting on the right side for once.
While driving to their new headquarters, a plane lands on the roof of their bus, and they meet another member of their team, Sanchez.
I thought I would not arrive.
The airplane! On the roof?
Right.
You do, man!
You couldn't just meet him at the bus stop? You had to hire a guy to attempt this near-suicidal stunt and trust the bus driver not to completely freak the fuck out? One swerve or one pothole in the road and everyone fucking dies! I can't even remember if Sanchez says a single line after this scene. All I remember is how pointless this is.
Captain Varelli, you're late. Your crew?
Yes. This is Pardue. Bashinsky.
Wait. Did he just say Pardue?
This is Pardue.
I am Pardue, a holy man.
That's a good idea! If you're going into a war zone, you would need a great holy man to cast resurrection spells. Sadly, Pardue doesn't say much, which is a shame. Next to RoboCop, having Tom Hanks running around a war zone throwing clerical magic and killing Gorvilles would make an awesome flick. Alright, so the A-team here is hired to assassinate the rebel leader, who is believed to be hiding in one of three villages.
Even great warriors such as Juande need sleep.
Because when you need someone killed with stealth and efficiency, you need look no further than Reb Brown. Yeah, I'm pretty sure there were rebels in there. You know, this is fun and all, but I really would have preferred just drowning these people.
We can't! The press!
Oh, fuck, you're right, I forgot! More explosions! Nothing to see here, folks! Nothing exciting about any of this! No human rights being violated here, CNN! Hey, I got an idea. Let's line up the surviving women and children up against posts and kill them with Uzis. I can't see the press possibly taking an interest in— Oh shit, the press! Get him! So, they capture a British photojournalist and a nurse in the village. The reporter makes the relatively poor decision to try to bluff with his "I'm a journalist, I can go anywhere I want" card, which, considering he just saw the guy machine gun 15 women to death, probably wasn't the hand to play.
I have a right to be here, Mr. Kim. I have accreditation.
Please, show Mr. Johansson to his jeep.
It's a trap!
Well, I guess he found a way to deal with that whole press problem. The bad guy's about to kill the nurse, too, when Reb finally steps in.
Drop it now, shitface.
Great hero, right? Stands there looking like a complete cunt while African civilians are massacred, but a white woman about to die? TJ Christian on the scene!
Get yourself a little R&R. But before you get yourselves too whacked out, I want you to offload that incoming chopper. It's just some special equipment.
And that special cargo? Babes!
Well, baby, me so horny. Me so horny.
You keep lying.
Me love you long time.
Actually, the ladies seem a little reluctant to entertain our heroes, and it's not because Superfly's too buku.
You guys stink. Beth or no abs.
That's hit the river.
Because I'm sure the filthy, muddy, parasite-infested river will do wonders for their hygiene. So begins an extraordinarily homoerotic scene of the men, and only the men, stripping down and getting in the water while the fully clothed women stay back and watch the entire time. The other guys run off with the women while Reb and Ron stay behind to swim more together? Wow.
I think you got the hot for that little lovely on the beach there.
No. See, I'm like a boxer, you know? No action before the big fight.
Women weaken legs.
But eventually Ron runs off to introduce his new urethral parasite with some friendly pubic crabs, leaving Reb to just spank it quietly in the river, I guess. But eventually he comes out of the water and, oh my god, say this isn't happening! Ugh. So the reporter finds Reb and somehow convinces him to go into one of the rebel villages alone to learn their ways and discover he's been fighting for the wrong side.
What is it?
Their puberty ceremony to initiate girls into adulthood.
Just wait till they start with the female circumcision! After that, Ruth takes Reb back to her hut and continues to plead her case.
They raped them. And then they raped them again with bayonets. And they mutilated them. And the blood started dripping down on me. I was hiding in the medicine cooler underneath the floor. And the blood started dripping down on me.
So of course, that's when Reb makes his big romantic move. Oh, I'm sure she's totally in the mood for Reb doggy style after bringing up the memory of her aunt being raped with a bayonet. Reb is so affected by these tales of atrocity and loss that he goes right back to his base to get ready for the next mission, killing the natives. But not before telling Ruth every single detail of the coming attack. Not because he actually cares about saving the natives, but because he cares about saving the white woman he just porked.
I gotta go.
Back to that village?
Which one? When were we up today?
Yeah. You're going there tomorrow morning.
I don't know.
But if you do, it probably won't be until tomorrow afternoon, right?
And guess what? She fucking tells the rebels, who set up explosives along the road and completely buttfuck their convoy. Chavez gets taken out by a sniper, and all we ever knew about the poor guy is that he liked to land single-engine airplanes on buses for fun. But damn it, he was a friend, and you do not kill Reb's friends and get away with it, by God. Warning, what follows is the manliest thing ever recorded on film. Your balls may drop off in shame at the mere knowledge that you will never in your entire life do something half this manly. In the side of my fucking van. And I'll bet you anything, Reb didn't hit a single goddamn thing one-arming this 50 cal machine gun. But the sheer sight of this vengeful white god is enough for Reb to completely demoralize the enemy and rally the troops and start picking up the survivors to retreat. But unfortunately, another roadside explosive overturns the Jeep and Peter Fonda just leaves him for dead.
He's had it! Let's go!
The rebels take Reb and nurse him back to health, and it's there that he finally realizes he's fighting for the wrong side, inspired by the rebel leader's dying words.
You are committing a genocide on people you don't know, for somebody you don't know anything about. Does that make you feel good, Mr. Christian?
Hell no, it doesn't! And you know what's really not gonna feel good is Reb Brown and Superfly Ron O'Neill pumping rockets up Peter Fonda's ass.
Turn around, Cliff! Kip is nuts! He'll kill her! We're on the wrong side, man!
All right, let's do it! Do it!
Somehow Varelli managed to abduct Ruth in the meantime, and I'm not really sure when that happened.
You fuck things up real good, Mr. Christian. But you gotta learn something. You don't fuck with the judge.
Let her go, Varelli. Let her go.
Don't be an asshole, Christian. This has got a 2-gram hair trigger, you got it? Now Kimba's my blank check.
And then Ron cashes that blank check by throwing a spear into the general's back because it's ironic? Then Varelli forgets how a hostage situation is supposed to work, shooting at the unarmed hostage instead of the 280-pound muscle-bound giant with a grenade launcher, missing completely anyway, and then trying to run, which doesn't work so well when you walk like a ruptured duck. Frankly, I'm blown away by this movie. Only Reb Brown could bring us a story this deep and nuanced. It's just got so many layers. It's got historical parallels, conflicted loyalties, a sense of discovery, and it's a tale about star-crossed lovers. It's about a Marine sent to a faraway land to help the government evict a native populace so they can exploit the area's natural resources. But after observing the native culture, he falls in love with his guide and becomes inspired by their noble sacrifices to maintain their way of life. At the end, he and his wisecracking pilot friend realize they've been fighting for the wrong side, join the rebellion, and drive off the invaders after a climactic final battle. Only Golan and Globus could come up with a movie so complex and visionary. I mean, where the hell else are you gonna see a movie like this?
So, you've seen mine. Now let me see yours.
Haven't you seen enough already?
Not of what I want.